In the latter half of the 20th century, the Boeing 747 became the most iconic plane in the skies. With its four engines and distinctive upper deck, the plane could fly several thousands of kilometers on a single load of fuel and carry over 350 passengers, depending on the seating arrangement. The plane was incredibly popular with airlines and the general flying public alike. National flag carrier airlines from all over the world wanted one of these planes for their fleets. Despite its admiration, though, the 747 would have many fatal accidents over its years of service. In this video, we're going to examine the first of these disasters, Lufthansa Flight 540. The date was November 20th, 1974. It was the morning hours of the day. At just before 7 a.m. local time at 6:57, a Boeing 747 landed in Nairobi, Kenya. The plane, belonging to the German carrier Lufthansa, was flying as Flight 540 between Frankfurt and Johannesburg, South Africa. The stop in Nairobi was needed for refueling and a change of flight crew. The pilots leaving the plane in Nairobi would note no defects with the plane. The plane itself was brand new. It was delivered to Lufthansa 4 years previously in 1970. It was actually just the second 747 to be delivered to the airline, and in its short life, the plane flew nearly 17,000 flight hours. When discussing this accident, I feel it is necessary to make note of a bit of historical information surrounding the 747 that's noted in the accident report. In 1972, another 747 operator noted a defect in relation to the leading edge flaps, also called slats, on the plane's wings. As discussed before on the channel in different contexts, flaps on the wings of airplanes, in the most basic of explanation, are extensions of the wings. When a pilot activates the flap lever from the cockpit, the flaps come out to the pilot's desired setting. The utility of this is usually found in takeoff and landing. It is the takeoff purpose that we'll be focusing on today. For takeoff, the flaps are used to gain more lift. The physically bigger wing provides a greater amount of this much-needed lift. The flaps on the 747 can be found on both the trailing edge and the leading edge of the wings. In 1972, as described in the accident report, an airline noticed a defect in where the leading edge flaps did not deploy. When the defect was noted to Boeing, it was considered to be an isolated incident. Boeing would also later state that their warning systems were adequate in warning pilots of any misconfiguration of the plane for takeoff. As it turned out, this was actually not an isolated incident. Multiple other instances also occurred, but were not reported to Boeing. On the day of the Lufthansa incident, Flight 540 would leave for Johannesburg before 8 a.m. By the time the plane would leave Nairobi, Flight 540 would carry 157 passengers and crew for the flight. On the flight deck, there were three pilots. Captain Christian Crack, age 53, had just over 1,600 hours in the 747. He was, however, highly experienced as a pilot overall, with over 10,000 hours logged. His first officer and co-pilot was the much younger 35-year-old Hans Schack. He actually had spent a bit more time in the 747, with just over 2,000 hours logged on the plane, and around a further 1,500 logged on other aircraft. The final member of the flight crew was the flight engineer sat behind the two pilots, 51-year-old Rudolf Hahn. He was the most experienced pilot with over 13,000 flight hours to his name. At 7:47, the co-pilot Hans Schack called the control tower for taxi clearance. The choice of departing runway was on this occasion given to the flight crew. The captain suggested the use of runway 24 this time. It was calculated that the plane was well below the takeoff weight limit, and so saw it to be desirable to make the southwesterly departure for a quick tracking for Johannesburg after takeoff. Nairobi Airport in the modern day looks very different to how it did in the 1970s. At the time, the airport consisted mostly of this northern side of the airport, where the accident plane was parked. Lufthansa Flight 540 taxied over Taxiway Charlie and backtracked on runway 06 to the far side of runway 24. It then turned around, lining up with the runway. The airport at Nairobi sits at an elevation of over 1,600 meters above sea level. How this relates to the plane's takeoff is that the thinner air at a higher altitude would mean a longer takeoff run would be needed to safely leave the runway. At 7:52, the Lufthansa flight was ready on runway 24 for departure. In their taxi out to the runway, the pilots would have run through multiple checklists to configure their plane for takeoff, including configuring the aforementioned flaps. The pilots were noted on the cockpit voice recording to have verbally expressed a setting of 10 degrees of flaps, and also noted the display of green light indications to show both the trailing edge and leading edge flaps had been deployed. When investigators arrived at the crash site of Flight 540, however, it was clear that the leading edge flaps were in the fully retracted position. Logically, one can easily now assume that either the leading edge flaps did not deploy when the pilots required it, or something was missed in the cockpit. A surviving passenger seated in the left side window seat in row 16, who happened to also be an airline pilot, noticed that these leading edge flaps were not deployed once the plane was airborne. So we'll now go from the departure, and there is a lot that happens in a short space of time, so we'll break this down a bit further. With clearance from the control tower, Flight 540 began rolling down the runway. The takeoff roll would also appear to be normal. The 80-knot callout was made as the 747 continued to accelerate towards the takeoff speed of around 138 knots, or 255 kilometers per hour. It was what happened in the rotation phase where things started to go wrong. All speed acceleration ceased, at least according to the timeline of events detailed in the accident report. By the time that Flight 540 would physically lift off of the runway, their speed would indicate 145 knots. But this did not increase much further. As the plane became airborne, the pilots also noticed birds passing by the nose, which would lead to some later speculating that a bird strike played a role. This, however, was determined to not be in relation to the disaster. In the following seconds, it should be noted that substantial engine vibration was noticed, and Captain Crack drew attention to this as indicated on the CVR transcript. The flight engineer would have then turned towards their panel detailing aircraft systems all over the plane. He then suggested that everything was okay on his end. The first officer would later go on record in saying that he noticed that all feeling of acceleration had ceased. He then lowered the nose to compensate for a slower airspeed to prevent a stall scenario and to stop the speed from decreasing further. With a time frame of just 19 seconds before the disaster would occur, the 747 barely climbed to 100 feet above the ground at a rate of 400 to 500 feet per minute. The vertical speed soon dropped to zero and the plane began to gradually fall. A psychological factor played a role in the pilot's actions during these moments. Anxiety surrounding the aforementioned engine vibration would lead to the flight crew not increasing engine power further. This all culminated in what the accident report describes as the plane entering a partial stall, as the plane dropped to the ground below. The tail section of the fuselage made contact with the ground just over 1,100 meters beyond the end of runway 24. The 747 continued to travel with the tail section scraping the ground for a further 114 meters before striking a roadway structure, causing the tail section to separate and disintegrate. Some passengers and flight attendants were ejected from the fuselage at this moment. The majority of the plane would continue to skid along the ground in flames for a further 340 meters. A fire in the left wing led to an explosion causing flames to enter the cabin. Once the plane had come to a halt, the pilots had survived and immediately began running through the necessary emergency checklists. All of the engine's fire switches were pulled. The pilots attempted to leave through the overhead escape hatch but were unsuccessful. The pilots were able to escape through other means and assisted in the evacuation of passengers until the fire and subsequent explosions forced them to abandon the smoldering wreckage. Passengers were largely unable to evacuate on the left due to the inferno outside. In the end, though 98 people survived the crash, the disaster of Lufthansa Flight 540 claimed the lives of 59 people. The investigation concluded that the incorrect takeoff configuration of the plane was the leading causal factor to the crash. The accident report even insists that, and quote, "there is no other evidence of any other primary causal factor." Curiously, that is not where the story ends. The investigation also concluded that the pneumatic supply, which powers the leading edge flaps, were switched off, and therefore did not respond when the pilots asked for the 10 degrees as desired. This would suggest evidence of pilot error. As it turned out, pneumatic bleed switches in the engine starter procedures required that these switches be in the closed position. It is the flight engineer on these early 747s who manages these switches. The after engine start checklist called for the pneumatic bleeds to be reopened. The actuation of the leading edge flaps were connected to the system being in the open position and will not respond unless this is done. However, it is believed that the flight engineer either failed to do this or inadvertently closed them again prior to the flap position being selected. Either way, the leading edge conclusively did not have its necessary pneumatic power. As it turned out, the accident plane had actually made numerous takeoffs with the leading edge flaps retracted. It was unfortunate in this case that the pilots did not apply the maximum available thrust. On top of that, the high elevation of Nairobi also limited the engine power available, as these previous leading edge incidents occurred at airports of much lower elevation. Other previous incidents would suggest that pilots noticed that even though that they were retracted, a signaling light would however suggest otherwise, that they were extended to the intended position. The investigation concluded that the existing indication systems did not provide an adequate warning to the pilots. Going forward, recommendations were made, including a modification to the 747's takeoff configuration warnings to include the position of the leading edge flaps, and that warning lights would be available to all pilots throughout the cockpit for both the trailing edge and leading edge. The 747 as an airplane went on to have a successful life and legacy. Although the newest type of the plane is produced in limited quantities, the plane is historically remembered fondly as one of the most iconic planes to ever fly. Hello everyone, thank you so much for watching this week's video. I've actually been ill this week, which is why I may have sounded kind of off in this video, but I'm feeling much better now. If you found this video to be interesting, be sure to be subscribed, as there is always a new video every Saturday. A big thank you to all the patrons over on the Disaster Breakdown Patreon for their support to the channel. Their names are scrolling on the screen right now. Thank you. Anyway, I feel it is necessary to really pay my tributes and respect to the individual who developed and created the 747 plane used in the flight simulation reconstruction segments of this video. He is an individual who goes by the name Fellis. He is also the person responsible for the Tupolev 154, which has also been featured in multiple videos on the channel. Fellis, if you didn't know, is actually Ukrainian, and I'm assuming all of you watching have not been living under a rock in recent times know the ongoing geopolitical situation in Ukraine. While I really can't provide anything new to the conversation surrounding the ongoing events, what I do have to say is that developers based in Ukraine have made invaluable contributions to the world of flight simulation over the years, and my videos simply wouldn't be the same without the work of someone like Fellis. I hope, given the situation of his country, he is doing okay. If you want to support him and his work, I'll leave a link to his Explain products at the top of the description of this video. In the last 28 days, according to my YouTube analytics, my videos have been viewed in Ukraine over 600 times, so if that is you, then please stay safe. That being said, I will sign off this video now. Have a great day, and I will see you next week. Goodbye!